So in this video, we're going to talk about what I think are probably the top five or six or something like that browsers. And this isn't supposed to be a list or something like that. It's really because I'm looking for a browser that is privacy centered, or not necessarily centered, but privacy respecting, and is still usable by normal people. Now, you may know that I use Brave as a browser. I highly recommend it. I'm going to talk about that briefly in this video. I did a video on it later, or you know, last month or something like that. But I want to talk about some other browsers that are worth using. And there's a justifiable reason to use all of these, okay? Because no browser is perfect right now, unfortunately. Okay, so let's start at a basic level. First off, what are the browsers that no one should be using? Now, everyone knows it's a total waste to use Internet Explorer or Edge because they log all your data, send them to Microsoft. They are terrible browsers in the first place. But the real pain out there, the real browser that people need to avoid nowadays is Google Chrome, which is literally just as bad. I don't understand why people even use it because literally every key press, every search you put in the search engine, every website you go to, all of that is logged in Google. There's no reason for you to use that, especially because of this browser that exists. This one that I have pulled up right here. This is ungoogled Chromium. It is exactly the same as Google Chrome, except for, actually, I think I have the website in history. It takes the Chromium engine and it strips out all the Google junk. So it doesn't have spyware, it doesn't have tracking, and it has sensible default privacy settings so that, for example, it doesn't share your geolocation with all these sites or search engines or stuff like that. So first off, I mentioned this one first because if you're a Chrome user and you're not going to watch the whole video, at least just switch to ungoogled Chromium because your privacy, your web browsing experience will be basically the same. It has all the features. It can take all the extensions, add-ons, whatever they call them that Chrome can take, except for this browser respects your privacy. Use ungoogled Chromium if you're a Chrome user. Now, I use Brave, which is another Chromium-based web browser. I'll talk about that in a second. But ungoogled Chromium looks the most like it, and it does all the same thing. Okay. Now, so the perks of ungoogled Chromium, you get all the functionality of Google Chrome. You don't have the tracking and stuff like that. There are some things that are a little annoying. Now, I'm looking for a default web browser to use with my .dot files, that when someone installs LARBs, when someone installs my .dot files, what browser should be the default? Ungoogled Chromium is a good choice for that, but it doesn't have, like, for example, it doesn't have a default web browser. Search engine, that's what I meant, okay? For example, by default, if you just put anything in the search engine, you know, it's not gonna search for it, it's just gonna check for a website. You can, of course, add search engines, but I want it to be usable out by default. Another thing is, although it's really good on privacy, now, of course, actually look at it. One thing you gotta appreciate is that it is minimalistic. A lot of browsers nowadays will just throw junk in your face. This one just has a couple of your most recent, you know, the couple websites that I looked at when I was using Chromium. I usually don't use it. But Chromium, ungoogled Chromium is good because it keeps it simple. It doesn't have like 30 task bars up there or something like that, okay? All right, so that's ungoogled Chromium. In general, I think it's a good choice. If you're using Chrome and you just want a better privacy-respecting browser, just use that. Now, what I use is Brave. I'm gonna show you what Brave looks like. Now, I'm not gonna talk too much about Brave because I did a video on this a month or so ago. Brave is a Chromium-based browser that generally, it takes out all the Google junk. It additionally comes with some extra features installed. For example, it has what I consider the bare minimum of what a web browser should have. It has an ad blocker by default. I don't know why browsers don't ship without ad blockers. Brave has an ad blocker by default. It automatically upgrades you to HTTPS when it can. And it also, as you may know, it has the Brave Rewards feature where you can voluntarily say, I want to view ads, and you will get their little cryptocurrency for it. That's just another little feature. It also has nice things like it has a built-in Tor window you can pull up. And you can use Tor if you have Tor on your computer. It has nice little features. It has the ability to use WebTorrent and all this kind of stuff. A lot of nice things built in. And this is what it looks like by default. It looks nicely. And again, this is basically the same as Google Chrome. Functions about the same. Has some extra features. Now, Brave does have, it doesn't have the spyware that Chrome has, but of course, a lot of these features, like this analytics here, is built into an analytics feature that it will check a website to get your analytics and stuff like that. So you can turn pretty much all of that off just like by getting rid of it, or you might have to change other settings in the browser. But in general, Brave is extremely good, extremely usable. I like it. It looks good. You don't have to customize it that much. Right now, it's the default browser on my .dot files because of all this. And although I don't like it, well, okay, I will say when you first start Brave, it will ask you usually for search engine you like, okay? So you can choose DuckDuckGo, you can use Quant. I have Cirx installed right now. But Google is actually the top choice at the very top, which I don't necessarily like, but maybe it's not too much to get upset about, because I really think people should just, I don't, stop using Google search. You don't need it. There are better searches, and Google, again, they're logging everything you put in there. So Brave is a good option. I prefer it to ungoogled Chromium. Obviously, I use it, and I'm using it on my .dot files now. So it's a pretty good browser. Now, another browser that has some really good features baked into it, but isn't quite as usable by default, is IceCat. So first off, Brave, my phone's ringing, let me get that. Okay, so what was I saying? Brave and Chromium are based on the Chromium engine that Google Chrome uses. So they're gonna be pretty similar in functionality in terms of what add-ons they can have. They're gonna be similar to Chrome. IceCat, on the other side, IceCat is based on Firefox. So it's gonna pretty much run like a Firefox browser and stuff like that. It takes the add-ons that Firefox does. Now, IceCat is made by the Free Software Foundation. It's made by the GNU project. And what that means is that it, you'll see this page here, you can activate or disable or whatever a lot of different features, like for example, geolocation. Okay, you can check that on. It, by default, it's off. You can disable all JavaScript whatsoever. If you don't want any proprietary software, you know, running on your in your web browser, you can do that. But the thing is, its default features, I will say, no, IceCat is a good browser. I'm not knocking it. But one of the things that comes with being a browser that is so privacy-centered is that a lot of things, I'm going to go to YouTube right now. First off, you'll notice YouTube is on the classical settings, which I actually prefer, the classical layout. But that is because IceCat cannot run a bunch of the fancy Java or blocks by default a lot of the fancy JavaScript stuff. Or you'll see if I clicked on this video again, I haven't changed my privacy settings, I haven't changed script blocking or anything like that. It's not going to be able to do all the privacy violating stuff that you usually do. Right now, if I were playing this YouTube video, of course, it's monitoring, you know, how much you're watching and all this stuff and sending that data elsewhere. By default, IceCat is going to block that stuff. So if you want to watch, if you want to do something that, you know, has proprietary JavaScript running or something like that, you will have to manually say, I want to allow that on IceCat or something else like that. It comes again with so many add-ons and stuff that it, you know, make this possible. Now, just bear in mind, I'm not trying to tell you this is a non-functional browser, but just remember that if you're using it, its target audience is people whose number one priority is privacy. And the only situation in which it's going to do anything that could even be slightly privacy violating is that unless you consent to it, okay? So just bear that in mind. If you install IceCat and if you want to do stuff like, let me go watch YouTube videos or something like that, or use some other site that has a bunch of analytics all over the place and is always monitoring what you're doing, you're going to have to, you know, manually say, okay, this is okay, that's okay. Whereas here's my site, it looks exactly how it's supposed to look because I don't have any fancy scripts running in the background or something like that. So most internet sites are going to be totally fine. But just bear that in mind if you're using IceCat. But IceCat, the idea behind it is fantastic. And I will say years ago, a couple years ago, if you installed IceCat, it never worked. Like everything was always broken. It was really annoying, but it's much better now. I showed you one example of the thing that's, you know, a YouTube video, which is that's probably the biggest thing that's gonna break on IceCat. But in general, it's a fantastic browser. And if you don't like any of those features, you can just manually disable them. Now, another Firefox based, you might say, oh, well, Luke, why don't you talk about Firefox? Because Firefox, of course, It is a it's based on a free software license and stuff like that, so it's free software. The reason I'm not going to talk about Firefox is because there's an alternative that is the same thing as Firefox, but a little bit better. I'm not talking about IceCat. I'm actually talking about WaterFox, because WaterFox is also based on Firefox, but it doesn't throw in all those security features that IceCat throws in. It's basically just like Firefox, except for different default settings. Okay, so this is what WaterFox looks like. Again, can take any Firefox add-ons, extensions, or anything like that. So same experience as Firefox, except for if you go into the settings page and stuff like that, it's going to have a lot of features that are going to be like, okay, well, geolocation is disabled by default, or other things like that. So if you like Firefox, so you just want to have more sensible default privacy settings, install WaterFox. Now, one thing that is questionable is that they don't use Google. Instead, they use Bing, which is basically just as bad. I mean, I guess if I had to choose, I'd rather have my data going to Microsoft, a company that I don't really use or care about, rather than Google, which is literally every. It's weird that Microsoft is now like the little guy in comparison to Google. But so I do think that having Bing over Google is probably an improvement, but it would be better if they had, at least DuckDuckGo or something like that. Again, I use Cirx as a search engine, but just anything, I don't know. No one's perfect. I'm just saying WaterFox is a little bit better than Firefox by default. And I will say, I know there are a lot of Firefox idealists out there who think that Firefox, you got to use Firefox because, oh, it's like the big anti-Google nowadays. Oh, it's like it's really waging the war. I mean, the thing is, Firefox gets money from Google. The reason that Google is still the default search engine of Firefox is because Google pays them to make it like that. Okay, Firefox has no reason to do that. They have no reason to make the competitor's search engine the default, but they do it because they're paid. Okay, so don't have any illusions about what's going on. I'm not really going to show you that much in WaterFox. It's basically the same thing as Firefox. Now, the last two browsers I want to talk about are somewhat unique, okay, both of them. The first one is Pale Moon. So Pale Moon has been around for quite a while. Pale Moon is was originally based on the old engine of Firefox years and years ago. But now I think it has sort of its own engine. I'm not quite sure. Pale Moon is not strictly based on Firefox or Chrome. It's its own thing, and it's a controversial browser. Now, I will say in privacy, now first off, look at the stupid default page. Absolutely retard. I don't know why they have this. I don't know why I need DeviantArt links on my page. It's so Newgrounds. I don't even know why that's there, in addition to all this social media garbage. But this is the default page of Pale Moon. And Pale Moon does a lot of things really good and does a lot of things really weird. And I don't want to talk about the negatives so much in this video. If you want, just look up Pale Moon. Look up I'll just say they're developed by a core team of somewhat insular guys. They all work together, and they have, I guess, a mentality to them that's a little weird. I'm not going to say much more than that. But that's one of the big deficits that people talk about when they talk about Pale Moon. But as a browser, in most situations, it's great. It has DuckDuckGo as default, as a privacy-respecting search engine. It runs pretty quickly. Now, again, since it's based on its own engine, it's nice and lean, and there's not going to be privacy-violating stuff in it by default. You do have to, it does have a much more, or I guess I should say, limited number of extensions that it can use, or add-ons and stuff like that. But in general, Pale Moon is a passable browser. I know it looks sort of goofy here. I have used Pale Moon in the past. I remember when there's that update to Firefox Quantum, I used Pale Moon for a while. But there were just little things. Like, I guess in its essence, I really like Pale Moon and I really like using it. But there will be little things that come up and annoy you from time to time. But I definitely recommend people to check it out, even if you don't necessarily. This is what web browsers used to look like, too. Sort of a classical feel to it. But I don't like not just that they throw this junk in here, but I don't need to see all these Pale Moon bookmarks and stuff. I'm using a browser. I'm not part of your club. I don't need all that stuff. I'm sorry. But in general, Pale Moon is a good browser. It has a lot of good privacy settings by default, or at least doesn't go out of its way to spy on you, which is what most browsers do. Okay. Anyway, the last browser is a browser that I have done. I did one of my first videos. You can actually look it up. I think I probably had 100 subscribers when I did this video on it. But the last browser is Qt Browser, okay? Qt Browser is, and I know a lot of people on my channel use Qt Browser, and what it's supposed to be is a browser that is based on, well, first off, it has Vim key bindings, so you use Vim keys to move around. You'll have to learn the settings or the all the different key binds to it, but by default, you know, you scroll up and down with J and K and stuff like that. It's a very nice, the nice thing about Qt Browser is that you can actually edit everything. You can change all the key bindings. You can, oh, first off, they have, you know, you can follow links by pressing F and stuff like that, and it brings up little, you know, it names all the links. You can just type, let's say, LS to go to the link that had LS on it. So it is supposed to be a keyboard-based browser. You never use the need to use your mouse. I mean, you can if you want, but every little thing about the browser is built in. It's a keyboard-based browser. It's Vim-based, so it's sort of targeted to an audience that's, you know, more power user. And the great thing about Qt Browser, and I haven't complained about this in the other browsers, but this is something that is all very annoying about them, is that Qt Browser has its own config files that you can manually edit in its configuration file folder. So you can go to config Qt Browser, and you can actually have all the configuration. I forget what the actual default, what is auto config? I don't actually know. Anyway, you could just check man Qt Browser or whatever it is, man Qt Browser, and get all the settings for that. But the nice thing about Qt Browser is you can actually change things without editing the browser, like opening the browser and going to the settings page. So it's like any other kind of program on Linux where you can modify .dot files and stuff like that. Now, there are negatives with Qt Browser, and that is, I mean, the main negative is not so much a real negative, it's just a recurring thing that'll come up. It is always sort of a work in progress. I think there's a very small, similar to Pale Moon, there's a small development team working on it, so there will be a lot of oversights, and there'll be a lot of weird decisions that they'll make. Qt Browser is much more customizable than any other browser out there. Now, you can check out my old video on Qt Browser, which is a little out of date. They've changed how you do the settings, but it illustrated some of the things you could do. Like, for example, in that video, again, they've changed the way these work, but I had a key binding that I could basically see an image and automatically save it to a particular folder, okay? Stuff like that. It's really nice to be able to do that in Qt Browser, but there are other videos out about it out there right now. I'm not going to give it, you know, a huge detailed review here because I don't have enough time and I haven't used it in a while, to be honest, but it's still good. And I think I might get back into it just so I can be able to talk about it now. Oh yeah. The other downside though about Qt Browser is, you know, on this channel, we like to hate Python. Okay. Qt Browser is written in Python. Oh, it's painful. But the nice thing about that is that even the settings file is actually in Python. So if you know any basic Python, you can go in and you could put ifs and, you know, all the just normal Python code to get what you want out of it. So that's a very nice thing. It's not just a normal config file that lists configuration settings. You can actually write it in Python and have programmatic things in that. All right. So anyway, that is my brief, I don't know, review. That's my brief statements about these couple of browsers. Again, ungoogled Chromium, Brave, both good Chromium-based browsers. Brave has a couple extra features. Ungoogled Chromium is more, there's more like nothing in it. There's no defaults. Both of them, if you are using Google Chrome, switch to one of those. There's no reason you shouldn't be using one of those because they don't log everything like Google Chrome does. It's fantastic. Just switch away from Google Chrome, okay? IceCat is fantastic if you want extreme privacy settings. You do have to think about, okay, I want to be able to watch YouTube videos, so I have to turn these settings off. But it's still a good browser. It's the best if you're looking for just raw privacy. Has Tor built in. Brave, of course, has Tor built in. I mentioned that as well. WaterFox, very nice browser if you just want Firefox with a couple privacy settings. And additionally, Pale Moon is its own thing. Figure it out. It's a good browser. Check it out. Qt Browser, same thing. It's its own thing. Qt Browser, you'll have to learn a little bit more about in order for you to actually get a lot of the features out of it. But there are a lot of other videos on YouTube about it that you can check out. My old one, but there have been more recent ones by other channels. Okay, so that's about it. Yeah, that's about it. Stop using Google Chrome. Okay. All right, see you next time.